Very good morning, students. Standard 6. Today, we will start with the next lesson, that is lesson number 8, our skeletal system and the skin. In this lesson, we are going to study the skeleton system of the human body and the structure of our skin and their functions. So, before starting with this lesson, let's recall some of the concepts which you have studied in your earlier classes. Students, here you can see the diagrams of the various organ systems, right? Now, the first one is digestive system. The second one is muscular system. The third one is skeletal system. Before this, students, do you know what is organ system? Students, in our body there are various organs. The group of organs performing similar functions together in a body is called organ system. So here in the first system, digestive system, there are various organs like mouth, pharynx, your stomach, intestines, all these together perform the function of digestion. The food which we eat, it converted into the energy and the waste materials are removed out of from our body. All this process is done with some of the group of organs and they form digestive system. Here in the second diagram, students, you can see the various muscles in our body. Students, muscles are nothing but the bundles of fibers that can contract and relax as required. So, this muscular system helps for the movement of the various parts of our body. For example, when we are walking, there are muscular system works like muscles in the thighs, muscles in our legs moves, they contract and relax and we can walk. So, there are various muscles in our body which helps for the smooth movement of our body parts. The third is skeletal system. Skeletal system is nothing but the bone structure of the any living organism. Here, we are going to study the bone structure of the human beings. You can see the picture of a skeletal system of a human being. Students, do you know that the various organs are safe within the body cavities? The human skeleton is a protective shell for all the internal organs. Students, tell me what happens when you fall down. You all know that there are various important and delicate organs are present in our body like heart, lungs, pancreas, gallbladder, brain, right? All these organs are protected from the any external injury because of the or with the help of the body cavities and because of the protective shells. Students, it never happened that if we fell down easily our brain gets any injury or our heart gets an injury. Why? Because it is always safe in the body cavities. Students, do you know which body cavities are there in our body? See here, I have shared one chart. Now, our heart is present in the thoracic cavity. What is the function of a heart, student? It pumps our blood. It circulates the blood. It is very important organ and due to the thoracic cavity, it is protected from the external injuries. Lungs, where is lungs presented? It is also present in the thoracic cavity. What is the function of a lung, students? Respiration. For breathing. And the third organ is intestines. What is the function of intestine? Digestion and absorption. Where in the abdominal cavity, intestines are protected. And the last and very important organ is brain. The function of a brain is control and coordination. It is secured or protected in the cranial cavity. So these various organs are safe within the body cavities, and the human skeleton is a protective shell for all the internal organs. Children, while playing, many a times we fall down, right? We may get injuries. Most of the times when we fall down, we get a external injury where we get the external bleeding. But sometimes what happens when we fall down or we meet with an accident, our bone may get a injury. At that time, we get an unbearable pain and the body part will start swelling. This is called a fracture. So sometimes when we fall while playing or have an accident, a bone in our arm or leg or in other body part may get broken. This is called a fracture of the bone. Fracture means what? We get the injury to the bone. It can damage the bone. A fracture in a bone causes severe and unbearable pain. Severe means very much pain and which we cannot bear, and the part with the broken bone starts swelling immediately. Students, you might have seen that some students meet with an accident or they fall in the school also. When they fall down and if they are getting a very much pain, their parents taking them to the hospital. Then the orthopedic doctors suggested them to get the x-ray. Now what is this x-ray? X-ray gives us the image of the bone. Now an x-ray image shows whether a bone is broken and also the exact spot where it is broken. This helps providing the proper treatment. Students, after we meet with an accident, what we should do? If you feel that you are having an unbearable pain and your bone is fractured, we should not move that fractured part. Immobilize it. Immobilize it means what? We should not move that body part and get an immediate help. After going to the hospital, an x-ray image is taken of the part which is swollen. As I told you, doctors always suggest us to get the x-rays so that they can find out the exact location where the bone got injury or where the bone got fractured. Do you know, students, these x-rays were discovered by William Conrad Roentgen. He is a great scientist, and because of this invention only today we can find out the easily where we get the exact fracture. Otherwise we cannot see or we cannot find where the injured bone is, and doctors cannot treat us well. So students, you might have seen that some of the kids or students, they are coming with the plasters in school also, right? And maybe you have seen some of the people who are having a plaster in the hospitals. So when they get a fractured bone, doctors applied a plaster to their bone so that they can keep that bone straight at a proper way, so that it will help for healing or joining in a proper way. Students, do you know that our fractured bones heal easily if our body has a adequate amount of a calcium and a phosphorus in it? In the previous lesson, we have studied that calcium and a phosphorus helps to keep our bone and a teeth strong, right? So when we are having any injury, like a fractured bones, we should consume the food which contains more amount of calcium and a phosphorus. It helps us for quick healing or quick getting a proper treatment. Children, now let us study about the human skeletal system. Now what is human skeletal system? Students, all the bones in our body are not of the same shape. Every bone is different. All the bones together form a framework or a skeleton. The skeleton gives a shape to the body. All the bones of the body along with the cartilage together form the skeletal system. Students, have you ever made any lantern. While making a lantern, first of all, we need to make a framework. We need to make the internal structure, right? We just join the sticks together and then we can give a shape to the lantern. Similarly, our body also requires a support, and to get a shape, it requires a framework. So this bones gives us a shape and a framework. Students, these bones are hard. They are not flexible. Students, you can observe your own bones also. Try to touch the bones of your fingers, your rib cage, your head. You will feel that they are hard. They are not soft or they are not flexible. Bones are composed of two main constituents. Bone cells are biotic, while calcium carbonate, calcium phosphate, minerals and salts are the abiotic constituents of bones. Students, bones are made up of two elements or constituents. First one, some are cells are the biotic constituents, and the others, calcium carbonate, calcium phosphate, minerals and salts, are the abiotic constituents of the bones. Calcium gives the strength to the bones. This we have already studied in the previous lesson also, that the calcium and the phosphorus gives the strength to the bones. Students, so what we have learned, that what is skeletal system? The system which gives a definite shape to the body, provides support and protects the delicate organs inside the body, is called the skeletal system. Students, our bones make a framework and it gives a particular shape to our body. Every animal has a different skeletal system. According to their skeletal system, they get the variety of shape and the size to their body. Here you can see the various animals and their skeletal system. By observing their skeletal system, we can easily recognize which animal it is, because this framework gives the shape to their body. In the first skeletal system, what you can see, this is a horse. The next one is the, what it is? It is a dinosaur. Then next is a fish, and the last one is a snake. So all these animals are having a particular skeletal system which gives them a particular shape, and it gives support to your body, as well as these skeletal system protects our all the internal organs. Students, we all know that all the internal organs are protected by the all these various bones, as those internal organs are delicate and these strong bones protects them from any injury. Students, as I explained, that all the bones in our body are not of the same shape. You can also observe your own bones. You can place a finger on your chest and press it. You can feel the bones over there. Okay. You can press or you can touch your head. You can feel the size and the shape of the bone which is there in your head. Same way, you can see or observe the bones in your hands, in your palms. Now you can understand that all the bones are having a different size and shape. There are four types of bones in our body. They are classified into four as follows. The first one is flat bones. Students, here you can see the two bones. These are two bones of our body. The first one is a placed or present in our shoulder place. It is called as a clavicle, and the second one is a sternum, which is present in the center of your rib cage. Where is your rib cage, students? Inside your chest. So if you press at the center of your chest, you will feel one bone, that is a sternum, which is a flat bone. The second type of bone is small bones. Students, easily you can find out the small bones in your palms or in your you can find the small bones. these all small, as well as, do you know where is the smallest bone? Inside your ear. Smallest bone is present. The next type of bones are irregular bones. The third is irregular bones. Student, in your vertebral column, you can touch your back. At the center of your back, you will feel a cushion like blocks are there, which are on one another each, right? So these are spines, or you can say these are the vertebral column. These vertebras, if you see it in this is a irregular bone, as well as in your hips, this pelvic girdle, it is also a irregular bone. After that, the last one is long bones. Students, in our legs and in our arms, long bones are. Very good morning, students. Today we are learning human skeleton system. Here you can see the human skeleton system. This is our own skeletal system. Skeletal system means your bone structure. So this is the bone structure of a humans. You can see the various parts, skull, rib cage, then bones of the hands, bones of the legs, then the pelvic girdle. So these are the various bones which are present in our own body. We are going to study about it. Before that, we will study the types of bones. In the human skeletal system, there are four types of bones: flat bones, small bones, irregular bones, and the long bones. Students, here you can see in the rib cage. In the rib cage, there is a flat bone in the center. This is a rib cage, and in the rib cage, in the center of the rib cage, you can see the flat bone. This is a sternum, as well as in a body, at the back side, at in a shoulder, you can see a one more flat bone. This flat bone is called as a clavicle. So these are the various names of the bones. This is a flat bones. Then the next type of bone is a irregular bone. Now, what are the irregular bones? The irregular bones does not have a particular structure. So you can see in the human skeletal system, this is a pelvic girdle which is present in our hips. Okay, so this pelvic girdle is all called as a irregular bone. And even these vertebral columns also does not have a particular shape. So this is also irregular bone. If we will see the lateral view of a vertebral column, it is a vertebral column, and its lateral view is given in your book also. This is a irregular bone. Then students, in the skeletal system, which bones do you see which are longest? The bones of the legs and the hands are longer bones. So these bones are long bone in the human skeletal system. The bones of the hands, which are called as a ulna and radius, this is a ulna and radius, and this bone is called as a humerus. As well as in the legs also, we are having a various bones like tibia, fibula, and this is the longest bone in our body, which is called as a femur. So these are the long bones in our body. Now students, in the skeletal system, which bones do you found small? You can see the bones of the palm and the foot. These are the small bones in the human skeletal system. Here you can see the bones of the palm. You can see carpals, metacarpals, and the phalanges. These are the names of these bones: carpals, metacarpals, and phalanges. So these are small bones in our body, as well as the bones of the foot. Here also you can see tarsals, metatarsals, and the phalanges. Here also you can see three, it is divided into three parts: tarsals, metatarsals, and phalanges. So these are the small bones in our human skeleton system. So students, do you understand that the four types of bones are present in our body? Flat bones, small bones,
irregular bones and the long bones. Even the bone of a skull, this is a skull. Even the bone of a skull is also a irregular shape. The pelvic girdle is also having an irregular shape, and the vertebral columns, it is also having an irregular shape. Then we have seen the flat bones. So the sternum, which is present in the rib cage, and the backside, you can see your shoulder bone, which is also called as a clavicle, is also a flat bone. Then we have studied the small bones. Small bones are present in your palms, carpals, metacarpals and phalanges, and in the foot, tarsals, metatarsals and the phalanges. These are the small bones. And which are the long bones in our human skeletal system? Your bones of the hands and the bones of the legs. These are the various names of the bones. Students, you don't need to remember all the names. I am just explaining you for the better understanding, that every bone in our body has given a particular name. But you just have to understand right now that there are four types of bones: flat bones, small bones, irregular bones and the long bones.
Students, now let's study what are the parts of the human skeletal system. I have already shown how the skeletal system looks. The human skeletal system can be divided into two parts. First one is the axial skeleton and the second is appendicular skeleton. The axial skeleton consists of the skull, the spine, which is also called as a vertebral column, and the rib cage. These are situated symmetrically along the central vertical axis of the body. Students, if we draw a straight line from the skull, you can see that skull, spine and a rib cage are situated symmetrically along the central vertical axis of the body. The second part is the appendicular skeleton. The appendicular skeleton is made up of the bones of the upper and the lower limbs. Upper and the lower limbs means your arms and your legs. Arms means your hands and your legs on either side of the central axis, which are on the other sides of the central axis. Now we will study it in the details. See here, students, these are the parts of the human skeletal system. As I said, if we draw a straight line from the central vertical axis, we can see that skull, rib cage and a spine makes a symmetrical line along with the central vertical axis, and arms and legs are part of the appendicular skeleton. Now first we will study about the axial skeleton. Now what is axial skeleton? In the axial skeleton, which three parts are there? Skull, rib cage and a spine, means your vertebral column. So first we will study about the skull. Students, where is the skull present? Skull is the bones which are present in your head. You can try and touch the bones of your head. You can feel that the hard parts are there below your hairs, right? Means this is a skull. Similarly, you can try to touch the face up to your jawline. So this is completely a skull. The skull is formed by the bones of the head and face. The bones of the skull are flat and strong. These bones are very strong, as we all already discussed, that it provides a protection to the very important organ, which is, we all know, brain. So skull provides the protection to the brain, and hence these bones are very strong. There are altogether 22 bones in the skull. Students, you might be feeling that this skull is together one bone, but no, there are 22 bones in the skull, 8 in the head part and 14 in the face part. But all these bones are fixed except the jaw. Your lower jaw, you can move your lower jaw. Because of that joint only, we can talk or we can chew the food, we can make the movements in the jaw. So only your lower jaw, not even the upper jaw, only lower jaw is a bone which can be moved. Okay, rest all bones are not moving. Only the lower jaw can move, and hence we feel that we can move or we can talk or we can eat also. The next is rib cage. Students, where is the rib cage? Rib cage is present in your chest. Beneath your chest, you can try and touch, you can feel the bones. So this is a rib cage, a cage like structure. So the cage like structure in the chest is called the rib cage. In the chest, there is one vertical flat bone at the center. Students, you can try to touch your center of the chest. This is a one flat bone which is called as a sternum. This is the central bone of your rib cage, and from there only various small ribs are connected to the spines. It is connected up to the spine. Where is your spine? Spine is your at the back. So there are 12 pairs of the flat bones called ribs are joined to the sideways, and these 25 bones form the rib cage. It is joined to the spine at the back. How there are 25 bones, children? 12 pairs of the rib cage means 12 pairs means one at one side, left and the right side. So there is 2 in one pair. So 12 multiplied by 2 is 24. So 24 ribs and one in the center sternum is 25th bone. So there are 25 bones in the rib cage. The next part of the axial skeleton is the spine. Spine is also called as a backbone or a vertebral column. Children, you can try to touch the center of your back. You can find a small stones or the pad like structures, right? Those are nothing but the vertebrae. So these vertebrae together forms a vertebral column or the spine. So the spine is formed by padlock shaped bones placed straight one above the other. Students, you can feel that these bones are started from the skull, means from your neck portion, right, up to the hip portion, where is your pelvic girdle. So up to there your vertebral columns are present. There are together 33 bones in the spine, each called that one padlock structure is called as a vertebra, and these bones are arranged one above the other flexibly. These bones are movable. They can move. They are flexible. The spine protects the spinal cord that originates from the brain. What is the function of the vertebral column or the spine? First, it protects the spinal cord which originates from the brain. And next is, because of the spinal cord only, we can show the smooth movements. What will happen, students, if we will not have a spinal cord or our backbone is not having a flexibility? We will not able to bend, we will not able to show the various movements just because of the vertebral column which is joined with one another. It is not a one single bone. There are 33 bones, and hence we can move, we can bend, we can show the flexibility in our movement. The next is appendicular skeleton. As we already discussed that skull, rib cage and spine forms the axial skeleton, and your lower arms and the lower limbs and the upper limbs means your arms and the legs forms a appendicular skeleton. So the human body has two arms and the two legs. Students, you can observe your hands and your legs. In your hands and in your legs also there are various bones, like your fingers, your elbow, and your arms also various bones are there. Similarly, in your legs also knee bones, your foot bones, okay, thighs bones are different. So all these bones together forms appendicular skeleton. The different parts of the arms and legs have several bones which are connected together by joints. All these bones are connected together by the joint. Students, now what is the relation of the all these bones and the growth of our body? Do you know that as our body grows, the size and the length of our bones also increases. Now you can compare your own picture of first standard and today's picture. Your body has grown up, right? Now when your body has grown up, your hands or your legs have become short only like the first standard? No, your hands, your legs, your skull also size changes, right? In the, when you were at first age or first standard, that time your the size of your face was small. Why? Because the size of the skull was small. But now you can see that your face has changed. It has become bigger. Why it has become bigger? Because the bones of your skull has increased. So such a changes in size and length can be seen in children according to the age. You can compare that the children of age 5 are having a different size, right? And you can see the children which are there in your class, their shape, their size is different. Why? Because of the size of the bones. However, the body continues to grow only up to a certain limit. Especially in the girls, it is up to 18 years old, and in the boys near about 20-21 years, they grow very nicely. So their body's shape is getting increased or there it is changing. The bones of the taller people are longer. Students, you might have seen that some kids in your class are very short while some are very long. It depends upon the size and the structure of their bones. If their structure and the size of the bones are short, smaller, their height will remain small. But in some of the people, this size of the bones are longer and bigger, and hence their shape, their size is different, and they are taller than the other people.
Students, if we draw a vertical line here in this human skeletal system, there are some bones which makes a symmetrical line, like in the skull, in the rib cage, and in the spine. So these three parts of the bones are made axial skeleton system, and the remaining bones of arms and the legs are called as a appendicular skeleton system. So basically, human skeletal system is divided into two parts, the axial skeleton and the appendicular skeleton. The axial skeleton consists of the skull, spine, and the ribcage. This is a skull, this is a spine, and a ribcage. So this total is an axial skeleton system, and the remaining bones of arms and the legs are form appendicular skeleton. So the appendicular skeleton is made up of bones of the upper and the lower limbs. Limbs means your arms and legs on either side of the central axis. So these are at the sides of the central axis which we made a draw if we draw a line. Now we will study the axial skeleton. In the axial skeleton, first one is a skull. See, this is a skull in the human skeleton system. Skull, though we feel that skull is an entire one bone, but no, there are near about 22 bones in the skull, 8 in the head section and 14 in the face section. You can see the markings in this skull. So there are various bones, small bones which are present, and these are joined. All these bones are flat and very strong. Why these bones need to be very strong? You all know that in our body, brain is very important, very important part of the human skeletal system, right? But it needs to be protected. So the skull is protecting our brain. The next one is a rib cage. This rib cage, now here which organs are present in the rib cage? Inside the rib cage, lungs and the heart is present. These are also very important parts of our human body, right? These are also very important organs. So these also need to be protected. So this rib cage and the protects the lungs and the heart from the any external injury. In the rib cage also, there are near about, you can see the rib cage. If you try to touch your chest, you can feel these bones. okay. This rib cage is made up of 25 bones. These are 12 pairs of the bones. 12 pairs means at this side one, at this side one. So these are 12 pairs. So total 24, and at the center a sternum is present. So here 12, this side 12, 24, and at the center this is a 25th. So there are total 25 bones present in the rib cage, which is protecting our heart and the lungs. Students, here you can see all these ribs. It starts from the sternum and connected to the backbone. This backbone is called as your spine or vertebra. And this vertebra is having a various vertebral columns, cushion the like structure. Due to this vertebral columns only, we can bend, we can show the swift movements of our back. Children, you can see here padlock like structures which are placed on one another. On each other, there are 33 padlock structures, and this one structure is called as a vertebra, and together it forms a vertebral column, or it is also called as a spine. So there are 33 bones in the vertebral column or in the spine. It is also called as a backbone. And the spine protects the spinal cord that originates from the brain. Students, do you know that there is a spinal cord, nerve-like system, which starts from our brain and it passes to our entire body. So this spine or this vertebral column is helpful for protecting the spinal cord. Students, you can observe here that all these small vertebrae are joined with each other. As these bones are joined with each other, because of this joint, we can move properly, we can bend properly. What will happen if this is a one single bone? We cannot bend, right? And hence these are the small vertebrae. We have to take care of all these bones. Nowadays what is happening, we are watching mobile, laptops, and the pressure is going to this vertebral column, especially in the neck section. Okay, these are the various discs. If there is a particular space provided in all these discs, if the space is reduced or if the space is extended, okay, then in both the conditions we may suffer a lot with the pain. We may get some issues like spondylosis or vertigo attacks. So children, please take care of your own body. These all bones are very important for our body.
Students, we have discussed our skeletal system. In the skeletal system, we have studied that there are various types of bones, such as flat bones, small bones, irregular bones, and long bones. As well as we have studied that the human skeletal system can be divided into two parts, the axial skeleton and the appendicular skeleton. But student, do you know that which is the smallest and the longest bone in our body? The smallest bone is present in our ear. There are three bones in each of the ears. Of these, the stirrup is the smallest bone in our body. The size of the stirrup bone is equal to the size of the rice grain. So students, you can imagine how small is this bone, and this bone is a hollow bone. The shape of this bone is like a stirrup, and hence the name is given stirrup. Students, do you know which are the longest bone in our body? We have already studied that the longer bone in our body are present in the arms and in the legs. But in this, which is the longest and the strongest bone? The longest and the strongest bone is present in the thigh. In the thigh bone, the name of this bone is a femur. Students, here you can see the picture of a stirrup which is present in our ear. This is the smallest bone in our body, and which are shown in the red color in our thighs. Femur is the longest and the strongest bone in our body. Now let's study how we can move our bones, our various parts of the body. Students, you can observe that we can move our body at different locations. Like in your hands, your hips, your legs, at particular place, we can bend it, we can move it, right? How we can move it? Because of the joints present over there. So, what are joints, students? Joints are the places where two or more than two bones are connected to each other. Students, in your house also, we have doors, right? So, this door is connected with the walls with some small instrument or a device. Have you seen that? With the help of that, we can open and shut the door. So, likewise, in our body also, two bones are joined with each other. Okay, and that is a joint. So, joints are the places where two or more than two bones are connected to each other. Now, you can observe in your hands, there are many joints. Started from your palm, you can find that there are near about three joints only in the finger part, then in the wrist portion, then in the elbow and in the shoulder portion. We cannot move it in between the elbow and the shoulder, right? Why? Because that is one single bone. There is no joint present from elbow to the shoulder, right? We can move it or we can bend it at the place of a shoulder or at the elbow. Why? Because a joint is present over there. Now, students, there are two types of joints present in our body. The bones in our body are connected to each other by means of a ligament. Now, how these bones are connected? With the help of a ligaments. Now, what are ligaments? Ligaments are like a thread-like structures which are connected to each other and helps for the joints. So, what are the two types of joints in our body? First one is a movable joint and another is a immovable joint. Movable joint means what, students? Which can be moved. Okay. And immovable joints, the bones which cannot be moved. Okay. And what are the movable joints present in our body? Where are these present? You can see that in our wrist, in your elbow, shoulder means in your arms and in your legs. So these are the movable joints as well as in your spine also, right? So all these are also movable joints. Now, which are immovable joints? Students, I have shared a video in which I have explained you that our skull is made up of 22 bones. Okay, and in that 14 bones are in the face and 8 bones are in the head. But when we observe your face or your head, you will find that only the lower jaw can be moved. Means what? The rest all bones are connected, but these joints are immovable joints. These joints cannot be moved. Only the lower jaw has a movable joint. Now, let us study the various types of joints present in our body. In the human skeletal system, there are three types of joints: hinge joint, ball and a socket joint, and a gliding joint. Let us study it one by one. Here you can see the hinge joint. Now, this type of a joint allows the movements of bones only in one direction. Students, where you can find or observe such a movement? In your elbow. Student, you can see that you can only move your elbow at one direction. It cannot go at the backward direction. Means at one direction only we can move this bone at 180 degree. You can make it straight, means it creates a 180 degree. So such a type of joint is called as a hinge joint. Now here you can see such a joint in your house, especially in the doors or even in cupboards also. If you are having a doors to your cupboards, it hinge joint is present, which allows us to open the door at one direction only, right? So this is the one type of joint which is present in our elbow, in our knee, right? So hinge joint is the joint which allows the movements of bones only in one direction. It moves in a 180 degree angle. For example, the elbow and the knee joints. The next type of joint is a ball and a socket joint. Here, students, the two bones are connected with each other in such a way that the first one has a hollow space like a socket and another is having a ball like structure, which allows for the complete 360 degree angle rotation. So where we can observe such a joint, students, in our shoulder. We can move our shoulder in a 360 angle, right? 360 degree angle, right? So this ball and the socket joint is present here. In this type of joint, the bones can move in two or more directions. So we can move our hand from the shoulder in front side, in back side also, in the upside also, in the downside also, right? Means we can move it in the various direction in a 360 degree angle. For example, is shoulder and the hip joints, as well as we can move our hip joint also in a 360 degree angle. So ball and the socket joint is present in a 360 degree angle. Here, the next type of joint is a gliding joint. Now, this type of joint is present in our wrist. Students, it is present in our wrist. In this type of joint, the bones can only slide over each other. You can try moving your wrist. You can find that the bones are sliding over each other. You can even, if you observe it carefully, you can observe a slight voice when you are moving it. So what is happening at that time? The bones are sliding over each other. So such a type of joints are called as a gliding joint. So this joint is present in a wrist and at the ankles. So this type of joints are the joints and which can slide over each other. Children, when somebody touches you, or if your mummy gives you tea or milk to drink, how you come to know which organ helps you to understand whether the substance is a hot or a cold? Sometimes we touch some of the substance and we found that some substances are smooth and some are rough. So which organ helps us to understand it? Skin, right? The skin helps us to sense whether the substance is a hot or a cold, whether it is rough or a smooth, right? Now, what is the skin? Skin is the outermost covering of our body. Students, you can observe your body that your entire body is covered with the skin from your head up to the tip of your toe, right? So, from the top of your head up to tip of your toes, the skin is covered. And hence, it is very important and large organ of all living things. Not only in human beings, but in other living organisms as well. Like in lion, tiger or snake, all these animals are also covered. Their body is also covered with the skin. So, this is the large organ of all living things. Students, you can observe that your skin has a hair on it. On the humans, we are having a small hair. On other animals, we can see that the hairs are very big. As well as we can observe that there are nails on the skin at the tips of the finger and on the toes also. Students, this skin helps us to protect our internal organs or the tissues or muscles which are present in our body from the external things. Like, it protects us from the viruses, bacteria. It helps to give us protection and avoid, or it creates a protection so that these bacteria or viruses will not enter in our body easily. The skin is an important sensory organ as well. Students, as we discussed just now, that how we can understand whether the substance is a hot or a cold, rough or a smooth, or if somebody is touching us, with the help of a skin. So the skin is important sensory organ of the body. The skin gives us sense of a touch. Now Let us study the structure of a skin. Students, while seeing the skin from the outside, we can only find the outer layer of the skin. Now, this outer layer is called as the epidermis. Human skin is made up of two main layers. The outermost layer, which we can see, is called the epidermis, and below that we can see, which we cannot see actually, is the dermis layer. The skin is actually made up of various layers. After the dermis, there is a subcutis or a hypodermis present. So, human skin is made up of two main layers. The outermost layer is called the epidermis, and the layer below it is called the dermis. Below the dermis means subcutis or a hypodermis, there is a network of blood vessels and nerve fibers. Students, when we are not feeling well, doctors are giving us injections. Through the injections, they are giving us some medicines, right? As well as if we need to do a blood test, that time also the nurse or the doctors takes a blood from these nerves. So what they does, they prick the needle inside the skin. So at which place they goes, they are taking the needle up to the below the dermis layer, where these blood vessels and the nerve fibers are present. So from these blood vessels, blood can be taken out for the testing purpose. The subcutaneous layer under this network maintains the normal body temperature. Students, do you know what is the normal temperature of a human body? 37 degrees Celsius, or we can call as a 98 Fahrenheit. When we are not feeling well, our body temperature rises. What happens? We are getting a fever. Students, when our body is attacked with any virus or a bacteria, when any bacteria or a virus enters in our body rises the temperature, and hence what we feel, that we are getting a fever. So when the body temperature increased than the 37 degrees Celsius or 98 Fahrenheit, we see that the person is having a fever. So who maintains this temperature of the body? The subcutaneous layer under the net, this nerve fibers and the blood vessels network. The epidermis has a various layers. Now students, let us study the functions of the skin. Children, we have already studied that there are three layers in our skin: epidermis, dermis and hypodermis, or it is also called as a subcutis. There is one pigment present which is called as a melanin in the cells of the epidermis. Melanin determines the color of the skin. The percentage of the melanin, if it is more in the skin color is darker. Children, melanin not only decides the color of the skin, as well as it protects our skin from the ultraviolet sun rays. Children, now tell me, what happens when we talk or when we walk or play outside, or if you are doing any physical activity, you may start feeling tired, as well as you will find some water droplets on your skin. Now, what are those water droplets? When we walk or play in the sun, we get tired, but at the same time our skin becomes wet. This is because of sweat. Children, now how this sweat comes on our skin? In the skin, there are glands which secrete the sweat. They are called sweat glands. Children, this is the cross section of a skin. Here you can see blood vessels, sweat gland, hair follicle and the fat layer. You can observe the sweat glands which are present in our skin. So these sweat glands secretes the sweat. There are some cells which secrete the sweat, and the pores, very tiny pores are there on our skin. From that skin pores, the sweat comes out and our skin becomes wet after doing any physical activity. So children, these are the sweat glands. Now, what is the use of sweat? Children, when we play or when we does any physical activity, we use lot of energy, and Because of that, our body started increasing its temperature. So to maintain the temperature of the body, sweat is secreted. So after playing in the hot sun or after hard physical labor, the temperature of the body rises, then sweat is released. It helps to reduce the temperature of the body. Children, do you know what is the normal temperature of our body? 37 degrees Celsius. If sometimes when the body temperature rises than this, we say that the person is having a fever, right? So this sweat always helps to maintain the body temperature. Children, now tell me, which color of the skin will give greater protection from the sun's rays? We have discussed that the melanin gives protection from the ultraviolet rays, right? And when the melanin is more in the skin color is darker. Means the people who with a darker skin color gets more protection from the sun, as well as it is very helpful. Now, children, tell me, how does sweating help to lower the temperature of the body? Children, if we pour a water on any hot surface, what will happen? The heat will get transferred to the cold place. Similarly, when our body, our skin starts secreting the sweat, the skin becomes wet and it helps to reduce the temperature of our body. Now, children, observe this picture. Maybe in your house also there will be a grandparents, or in your surroundings you might have seen some grandparents. Children, observe your skin and your grandparents' skin. You will find a difference in your and your grandparents' skin. Why it happens? Children, I had shown that there is a fat layer beneath your skin, right? So what happens when we grow older, the proportion of fat beneath the skin reduces, the fat layer gets reduces, and hence we feel that the skin of the older people is shrinked, it got a wrinkles. But however, the previously taut skin does not shrink, it is not actually shrinking. What is happening? As the fat layer beneath the skin is reducing, we feel that the skin got shrink, and this causes wrinkles on the face, on the skin of the older people. Children, you might have seen some people with a different colors of hair, right? Some people are having a black hair, some are having a brown, some are having a reddish color hair, and some are having gray or white color hair. Do you know that the color of a hair is also depend upon the melanin present in our skin? Children, like the color of a skin, melanin also determines the color of our hair. The jet black color of hair is due to the pure melanin, while brown, lighter hair is due to the sulfur in the melanin. Whereas some people are having a reddish hair, it is due to the iron in the melanin. Children, do you know that there are people are discriminating other people on the basis of their skin color? In India, we discriminate people according to their skin color. Not only in India, but the developed nations like America also does the same. They also discriminate people according to their skin color. Discriminate means what? They treat them as a lower category due to their color, and it is called as a racism. Children, there are many people who suffered because of this mentality of the human beings. Children, if we know that this color of the skin is totally depend upon the melanin present in our skin, we should not discriminate people. These are the scientific facts. We should accept it, and we should understand that every color is a beautiful color. Every skin color is absolutely beautiful. Children, we say that all the colors are made by nature or the God. So the colors which are made by the God or a nature, though maybe it can be white, brown, red, black, whatever, it is beautiful. We should not discriminate any person according to their color. Children, do you know that in last year 2019, Zozibini Tunzi, she became a Miss Universe. She won the crown of Miss Universe, though she had a black color skin. She said the new quote that black is beautiful. So children, we should also not discriminate. We should not tease anyone according to their color. Children, we should always remember that for the health of our skin, it is important to keep it clean. So what we should do to keep our skin clean? Always we should have a bath regularly in the morning. Then we can clean your hands regularly after having a milk or after using a washroom. These are some basic hygienes which we should maintain. Discriminating people based on their skin color is unscientific and wrong. Children, just now we have studied that the color of the skin is totally depend upon the melanin present in the skin. So if we discriminate any person according to their color, it is unscientific. So what we should do? We should not discriminate any person according to their color and avoid the temptation of using artificial means to become fair. Children, even it is showed in the movies or in the advertisements that the girl should have a white color skin, they should have be fair, but it is not fact. It is a wrong statement. We should not use any cosmetics or any artificial chemicals, creams on our skin to become fair. It is totally wrong to use the cosmetics on our skin. It may create some itching sensations or it may create some irritations or problems to your skin. So avoid using any cosmetics on your skin. The color which you get will always be remain same. It is not going to change. Sometimes because of the cosmetics, it has a bleaching in it and hence it enhances your color. But actually it is damaging your cells of the skin. So we should avoid it. And instead using the cosmetics, what we can do? We can keep our skin healthy by keeping it clean. So children, what we have learnt in this lesson? The various organ systems like digestive system, muscular systems and a human skeleton system. So in this lesson, we have studied the human skeleton system in detail. In that we have studied the various types of bones which are present in our body: flat bones, small bones, irregular bones and long bones. Children, what we have studied then? All the bones in the body along with the cartilage together form a skeletal system, and the skeleton gives the shape and support to the body. Children, after that we have studied that the human skeletal system is divided into two parts: axial skeleton and the appendicular skeleton. In axial skeleton, three parts are there: skull, ribcage and the spine. And in appendicular skeleton, the two arms and legs are there. Then what we have studied? We have studied about the skin, and as well as we have studied the various types of the joints which are present in a human skeleton, like hinge joint, ball and a socket joint and a gliding joint. Then we have studied about the skin. The outer covering of the body is called the skin. It is the larger organ of the human system. Then students, we have studied that the skeleton system and the skin perform the important function of protecting the body and the internal body parts. Skeletal system, it protects all the internal organs from any external injury, and skin also protects from any external injury, as well as it works as a protective shield. We must take care of our skeletal system and the skin. Children, not only these things, but all our body parts, organs are very important You can ask your parents ki what how much cost it will be needed for any transplant of the body part. It takes lot of money as well as lot of pain for doing that. So the nature has given us this all body parts, all the internal organs in a well manner. So we should always take care of all these parts of our body. The skull, the ribcage, the backbone and the bones of the arms and legs are the main parts of the human skeletal system. Then children, we have studied the structure of the skin. There are two main layers of the skin, epidermis and the dermis. And the third layer is a hypodermis, or it is also called as a subcutis. Then children, we have studied about the melanin, sweat glands, right? The melanin decides the color of our skin as well as it decides the color of our hair. The sweat glands helps to secrete the sweat, which maintains the body temperature. Children, after that we have studied that we should not discriminate anyone according to their color, as this color is given by the melanin. So these are the scientific facts which we should understand.